Him from the flames, I found myself the subject of my own early fairy stories, waiting for the boys to set me free. But now, instead, I find myself trapped more and more than ever in my own Neverland by my affection for Michael. Neverland is that place we all seek in childhood, but only find in dreams and imaginations. And I fancy I try to create an imaginary world for myself. For the one I really inhabit, and the only one I can do any good in, is too somber. I've been having a bout of this depressing time since we landed on Eileen Shona, and I've little to show for it, but a severe philosophic countenance.
If you don't stand still, said House, I can't possibly catch you in pencil or charcoal.
I'm so terribly bored, David. Even the cricket match had more excitement than this. We daren't go near the house for fear of stumbling upon another strange discussion between Mary and Uncle Jim, or else we get shooed away from this box and monopolizing the old chap.
Well, we didn't come here to spend all of our time in the house.
Besides, it's their affair, not ours.
I'd be very glad if there were any affairs for us on this island. It's all so bleak and devoid of affection. Even the goats are beginning to look quite attractive.
For God's sake, Senhouse, be still.
And what about you? You've been so snappy ever since Uncle Jim's monopolizing Buxton, hasn't he, Uncle Jim?
Yes, I thought he was supposed to be your friend, David.
You've been provoking arguments over every petty little thing, and kept it going on long after you should have given way and made amends. The atmosphere around here is like soggy porridge.
Sorry, Senhouse.
Boothby,
it hasn't been much fun, really.
But one saving grace has been Miss Aniston.
Yes, when she can tear herself away from her fiscal finangling.
I say, why don't we invite her and the others for a picnic?
Where?
There's a lovely little spot not far from here. And Mary hasn't seen much of the island yet.
I say, what a splendid idea. What do you say, Boothby?
Yes, sounds a great deal better than trying to convince the child I'm any sort of fisherman.
Well, why don't you both go make the arrangements with the others and then bring everyone back here?
We'll do our best.
Are you coming, dear?
I want to avoid the house as much as possible for the time being.
No, all right.
And don't forget to bring some chocolate cake.
Of course. What picnic would be complete without chocolate cake? Shall we, Boothby?
Yes, we shall return, ladies. Senhouse. On that!
Should you pass any traffic goats on your journey, then please invite them along.
Yes, it's me. What about that swimming lesson, Davies?
I did bring my bathing costume.
No matter. No one will see you.
Why are you doing this, Buxton?
More of mine, if you like.
And what would you wear, might I ask?
Perfectly natural. We're all born that way.
You wouldn't.
I see I'm wasting my time here.
Yeah? Oh, no! Why don't you let me sketch you?
So, the day's not been wasted after all. How would you like me to pose?
Not like that. Something noble, a warrior-like. No, that's not quite it.
How about this?
Perfect. Can you hold that pose for a while?
Of course, Davies. I can do anything I set my mind to.
Let me know when you want to rest.
Will it take terribly long?
Mind, try to do it properly.
We have all afternoon.
Please, try to remain still, perfectly still.
Am I allowed to speak, Davies?
As long as you don't move your mouth.
How's it going?
I've scarcely begun, Buxton. Have a little patience. You have the most exquisite profile I've ever sketched.
Please don't talk about it. Get it down on paper. I sense all is not going well in the world of fine art.
There's something dreadfully wrong, I don't know.
Give me a look. What am I supposed to be?
A heroic Celtic warrior?
What?
heroic Celtic warrior.
Is that how you sing it?
Yes. Yes, it is. I stole it from Mary.
Well, why didn't you say so? I know what the problem is. Celtic warriors never wore bathing costumes.
Buxton! You can't just... What if someone... Buxton, put your clothes on! I've never been so shocked!
My balls off standing like this.
You're quite right. It's much better.
I may know nothing about, but I do know how to pose.
There's someone coming! Quick! Hide! I put your clothes on! No!
Then finish it!
Oh dear, that's a sight you don't often see while walking the Scottish Highlands.
Oh my God, Buxton!
Put some clothes on. There's a lady, but have you no shame? Matter of fact, none. What do you say, Miss Barrett?
I think it must be very cold.
Clothes on, Buxton.
Why don't we all join to the other little spot down the stream and set up and wait until the great artist finishes, and then here Mr. Buxton can join us. Come along this way, that's right, Harry. Nico. Nico!
Don't you ever do anything that's expected of you?
Never.
Lived an awfully long time.
When I die, I shan't be remembered as ordinary.
You think that's an admirable goal to have in life?
Don't you have a goal in life?
To be happy, I suppose.
Everyone has that goal. Come on, something different.
All right. I should like to fall terribly in love.
Can't you think of anything more original than that? Something a little more adventurous? Don't be so wet.
I can't help it. It was the way I was brought up.
With James Barrett your guardian, I would have thought that'd be enough to set you furiously to think.
And so I do. Sometimes. Most of the time.
What are you thinking about this very moment? Come on, own up!
I was merely thinking... how much I would like it if you were to teach me to swim.
By the time I finish with you, you'll be swimming like one of the trout in the stream.
Please be careful, Buxton. I'm frightened to get in over my head.
Then we shall start out easy. In fact, we shan't even go in the water at first. What? Until you gain confidence.
How then can I learn?
I should teach you the arm movements first of all, and then how to keep your legs. Practice does not make perfect. Perfect practice makes perfect.
Such an idiot's not being able to swim. All the other chaps that Eton could.
Soon you'll be able to swim as well as you play cricket. Just follow my example.
I'm terribly glad you came, Buxton.
I'm terribly glad I came too. I was just so tedious after you departed, and all the other fellows at school were so dull and tiresome in comparison.
Though I shall never ever forgive you.
You said it once before.
And don't remind me of that city. All my behaviour there.
Not even to make you angry?
Not even that.
And of course, you must kick your feet at the same time.
Am I doing this right? Surely there's more to it than that.
Almost. Now, here, let me show you.
Is that better?
You know just how comfortably we fit together. I noticed it in Paris when you waited up for me with that red wine and bread. I thought, as a chap, I wouldn't mind...
Go on, Buxton. Wouldn't mind what?
I wouldn't mind as a friend.
Well, at least life would never be ordinary or conventional.
But in order to learn how to swim, one must first get their feet wet.
Thank you.
child finds Captain Hook a grotesque figure, albeit a little comic. But in reality, he is a tragic and rather ghastly creation who knows no peace and whose soul is in torment. A dark shadow, a sinister dream, a bogey of fear who lives perpetually in the grey recesses of every child's mind. I am reminded of this constantly by the manner in which I am treated by Michael's young men, and I feel as lonely as God.
What are you looking at, Uncle Jim?
Ah, I was just admiring the scenery. It is so beautiful. For a moment I half expected to see a postage stamp in one corner, signifying it was nought but a fantastical picture postcard.
Yes, whatever else one may see of this island, the scenery is rather breathtaking.
With rivers, mountains, and goats, if you're liking.
Oh, do buck up, Boothby.
With the damnable weather, Nick, of sunny one moment, and the next the heavens open up unexpectedly and quite drench us.
Oh, well, not quite so unexpectedly, Mr. Boothby. There's normally a growl of disapproval from the thunder that anyone should like sunny weather.
This is a foul outcrop.
At least when it rains, I get my work done. When it's sunny, I feel quite tempted out of doors to activities that I wouldn't attempt otherwise.
You're still an active man, James.
Aye, but I'm constantly reminded of my frailty on this island, Mary. Why, when I come back from prodigious walks over mountains whose very names call for stout climbers, and cheered on by the thought of mild boasting at afternoon tea, I'm constantly told by Mr. Buxton or Michael that the achievement is nothing and merely the warm-up